Good morning and welcome to FPC Ambler. My name is Eric Dorvier, one of the pastors here. It is so good to have you worshiping online with us through Facebook or YouTube. We always have a lot of things going on in the life of our church. I invite you to visit our website for more information, fpcambler.org. And as we begin to think about what life looks like and ministry looks like together as we come back together to worship the Lord, we've begun to realize we have a great need to continue our recording and live streaming services. So if you love technology and want to serve God in that capacity, I invite you to contact Pastor Ryan through email. We would love to have you serve on our team so we can continue this ministry as we come back together. Let us now prepare our hearts to worship the Lord. We will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With our mouths, we will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. We declare that your unfailing love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Let us worship God together.
Jesus, all your fears. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed are those to whom God imparts no iniquity, and whose spirit there is no deceit. Let us confess our sins together before God, trusting that our sin will be forgiven. Let us pray. Almighty God, we have gone our own way, not loving you as we ought, nor loving our neighbor as ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, through what we have done and what we have failed to do. We deserve your condemnation. Father, forgive us. Help us to love you and our neighbor and to live for your honor and glory. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Rejoice and be glad. Our God is full of mercy, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. God gives us the gift of new life. Friends, be at peace and know that you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. This week we're going to continue our series called God Didn't Say, where we examine some ideas about what people think God said, but when you look at the scriptures, we find out that's not what God said. And as we look at the scriptures, we're going to think more deeply about what God has said to us and what God promises us. Today we're going to be thinking about how God didn't say that life will be fair. Before we begin, let's pray. Lord, we give you thanks for this day. Lord, that we can be gathered together across our homes and through the internet, and we can be gathered together to worship you. Lord, we trust that you are in our midst by the power of your Spirit. God, we ask that you would open our ears that we might hear your word, and open our hearts that we might receive it, and enable us by your Spirit to live it out with hope and the confidence of your children. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Like I said, we're thinking about how God didn't say life will be fair. If you were to look through all of scriptures, you would find that that's not something that God promises to us, that life will be fair. What we do find is that there are plenty of situations throughout the scripture where we see that life seems rather unfair. We see Moses in the book of Exodus who stands up to defend another Hebrew who was being attacked by an Egyptian, and he killed the Egyptian in the process. And then instead of being thanked or being seen as a hero, he was pointed out by his fellow Hebrews as a murderer, and he had to flee and to live in hiding for years. We have the psalmist who again and again cries out, "Why do the wicked prosper?" We have the book of Job who has a series of horrible events that happened in the course of his life, all of which seem to be so unfair. And in the New Testament, we also see how life seems unfair. Peter, James, John, and Paul all were thrown into prison simply for speaking about Jesus, for healing the sick, and for raising the dead. And then, of course, there's the greatest injustice of all. When Jesus was put on trial and convicted and crucified, not because he was guilty, but because he was a threat. And again, we see that it seems that life is unfair. But in many ways, we didn't need the Bible to tell us that life was unfair. We know it from personal experience, don't we? Now, we all have an idea of what fairness means. We all believe that fairness means that we have a level playing field, that whoever's making a judgment or a decision makes that judgment or decision based on the merits, not based on some predetermined, pre-ordered set of facts that they believe that is unknown to you. Now, we might disagree exactly on how we make the world more fair. There are some who believe that we ought to have fairness or equity in outcomes. There are some who believe we ought to have fairness or equity in opportunity. I'm not here to resolve that question today or even really to weigh in on it, but we do all have this sense, this fundamental sense, that we long for life to be fair, and don't we wish that God had told us that life will be fair? But that's not something God has promised to us. As a matter of fact, we also know what it's like to experience when life seems unfair. One example is when you're watching sports, we always presume that things should be fair. But if you're a real Eagles fan, you have a very distinct sense of inequity and unfairness. Now, I know the Eagles finally broke through and won the Super Bowl in 2019, and it was a great celebration. But you know a true Eagles fan, if they're still bitter about the Super Bowl that happened in January 2005. As a matter of fact, when I was thinking about this sermon, I mentioned it to Eric, and he had this grimace on his face the second I mentioned it, because he knew exactly what I was talking about. The fact that just a couple years later, the New England Patriots were caught cheating by filming their opponent's sidelines so they knew all of the plays that were coming in. And if you watch that game, you know that the Patriots seemed to know what was happening throughout the second half of that game. And it just seems to be so unfair that the Eagles were on the way to win the Super Bowl in 2005, and it was stolen away by a team that cheats. But I suppose that fairness, to some degree, is in the eye of the beholder. Because if you talk to a Patriots fan, what they'll tell you is they were simply taking advantage of every opportunity. Alas. Well, we also see unfairness in more serious places. When we look at our society, we hear all the time about economic injustice, about how it's an unfair society, about how billionaires prosper while the rest of us work so hard and struggle to get ahead. We hear about income inequality. We hear about inequality based on where you were born or the school you went to or the color of your skin. And we know that all of this sort of inequity is unfair, and we also know that it exists. The question is, for us as Christians, what are we to do about it? What does God tell us about living in a world that's not fair? I suppose the place where we most acutely experience and know how unfair the world can be is when we personally experience how the world is unfair. When I was 18 years old, I was a senior in high school. I was visiting a friend, and he lived in the city, and I was driving back to my house, and it was late at night, and I was driving on an almost deserted highway. As I was driving home, I looked in my mirror, and I saw someone flying up on the left-hand side. It was someone in a Porsche, and he blew past me. He had to be going 20 miles an hour faster than me. And maybe a quarter mile ahead, we went under an underpass. And on the other side of the underpass, hidden by one of the pylons, was a police officer. And I saw him pull out, and I thought to myself, that guy in the Porsche is gonna get it. And the police car accelerated quickly, and he came up, and he didn't get in the left lane. He came up behind me, and he turned on his lights, and he pulled me over. I was a little shocked, but I pulled over, and he asked for my license and my registration. And he came back, and he had my license and my registration and a speeding ticket. So I pointed out to him, I said, didn't you see that other car? He was going 20 miles an hour faster than me. Why didn't you get him? His answer to me was, I don't care about him. I wanted to give a ticket to you. 30 years later, it still seems unfair. When we experience inequity, when we experience something unfair, it can lead to bitterness, it can lead to anger, and it can lead to frustration. Sometimes when we look at bigger cases of unfairness, when we look at the inequity of the world, when we look at how unfair it is, that some people suffer while others prosper, it can make us even doubt our faith. This morning, we're going to be looking at two different passages, and one of them is the 73rd Psalm. I would encourage you, if you have your Bible, to pick it up and to follow along, because I'm going to look at it section by section. This psalm begins with an almost formulaic word of praise. It says, "Truly God is good to the upright, to those who are pure in heart." This is one of those statements that was almost formulaic. It was almost like a proverb, that surely God is good to those who are upright. And then the psalmist goes on in verse 2 and says, "But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled, for I was envious of the arrogant, and I saw the prosperity of the wicked." The psalmist, his foot almost slipped, he almost stumbled, he almost lost his faith. He almost lost his faith because he looked at the world and he saw how the wicked prosper and he saw how unfair things seemed to be, and he was angry and he was upset that the world is the way it is. And then he goes on in verse 4 to describe the situation. He says, "For they, the wicked, they have no pain. Their bodies are sound and sleek. They are not in trouble as others are. They are not plagued like other people. Therefore, pride is their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Their eyes swell out with fatness. Their hearts overflow with follies. They scoff and they speak with malice. Loftily they threaten oppression. They set their mouths against heaven. Even their tongues range over the earth. Therefore, the people turn and praise them and find no fault in them. And they say, how can God know? Is there knowledge in the Most High? Such are the wicked, always at ease. They increase their riches." The psalmist is pained as he looks at the injustice of the world, as he looks at how unfair it seems, as he looks at the wicked. The psalmist is struggling with the fact that the wicked seem to prosper, while those who seek to be righteous seem to suffer. And he says, it's not just him, but it says that everyone began to question. In verse 10, "Therefore the people turn and praise them," praise the wicked, "and find no fault in them. It even leads them to question God. How can God know? Is there any knowledge in the Most High?" The psalmist was wrestling and struggling with how to deal with the unfairness and the inequity of this world and this life. In verse 13, he continues, "All in vain I have kept my heart clean and washed my hands in innocence. For all day long I have been plagued and am punished every morning. If I had said I will talk on in this way, I would have been untrue to the circle of your children. But when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me a wearisome task." Here we hear the psalmist agonizing over the fact that he has sought to be righteous. He has lived with an upright heart. He's tried to follow the rules and he's tried to do it right, but yet he still believes that he is unjustly and unfairly suffering, and it's not just him. He looks around at the whole world and he asks himself, why is it that the wicked seem to prosper but the righteous seem to suffer? Why is it that it seems that the world is so unfair, and how can I set it right? How can I understand it better? And the psalmist tells us that when he thought how to understand it, in verse 16, we thought how to understand this, when he used his own wisdom, his own effort, and his own knowledge, it seemed to him a wearisome task. It wore him out. It made him tired. It was wearisome to him to think about how the wicked prosper and the righteous suffer. It was tiring to him to think about how unfair life can be. But then in verse 17, we have this turn in the psalmist's journey. "When I thought of how to understand this, it seemed a wearisome task," verse 17, "until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I perceived their end." Truly, you set them in slippery places. You make them fall to ruin. How they are destroyed in a moment, swept away by utterly by terrors. They are like a dream when one's awake. On awakening, you despise their phantoms. When my soul was embittered, when I was pricked in the heart, I was stupid and ignorant. I was like a brute beast toward you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you will receive me with honor. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire more than you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart, my portion forever. Here's what happens in this passage. The psalmist starts out with a word of praise, and then he raises a complaint to the Lord. His complaint is, why is life unfair, and why do the wicked prosper? And then he spells out how he sees the wicked prospering, and he says that it was such a challenge for him, it was such a difficult thing for him to understand, that it was wearying to him, he says, for him to consider how to understand this and how to frame it, and that he needed a new and a different perspective. You know, many times for us, we need that new perspective too. And when we think about this new perspective, when we think about why the wicked prosper or why the world seems unfair and how we can make sense of it, one of the things that we often do is we turn and we don't look to God. Instead, we look to the world around us. And we look at other people and we say to ourselves, well, it could be worse. Look at so-and-so. Their situation is far worse than mine. Now, that might be a helpful way for us to make it through the day. And it's a good coping technique, and it's not that we ought not to look around and to be thankful for what we have. But the psalmist gives us a different remedy, one that I think is perhaps more helpful, and a remedy that is probably something that is more sustaining in the long run. And his remedy, in verse 17, is that he went into the sanctuary of God. The psalmist, when he was in despair, when he was overwhelmed by the inequity, the unfairness, and the injustice of the world, when he was overwhelmed by the fact that the wicked prosper, the psalmist went to the sanctuary and he worshiped. He put himself in the presence of the Lord. And in the presence of the Lord, he was reminded of two things. Number one, that God is the ultimate judge. Therefore, this idea of making judgment is taken out of his hand and placed in God's hands. The second thing that he is reminded of, and I love this image that he creates, this image that he makes for us, where he says that he walks with his hand, with his right hand in God's hand. In verse 23, nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold my right hand. One of the ways that we come to terms with how unfair this life can be is through worship, through bowing down to the Lord, through lifting our hearts in prayer. Not so that we see the rest of the world and see that it could be worse, but instead that we see what we have and the value of it. That we have been promised not that life will be fair, but that God will be present with us, that God walks with us, that he gives us this gift of his very self to be with us, even when we feel that we've gotten the short end of the stick. The psalm concludes, indeed, those who are far from you will perish. You put an end to those who are false to you. But for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord my God my refuge to tell of all of your works. One of the beautiful things the psalmist does is he starts and he ends in very much the same place, but he's made a subtle shift. At the beginning of the psalm, he says, truly, God is good to the upright, to those who are pure in heart. He makes this general statement, this proverbial statement, one that could be made by anyone. But at the end of the psalm, after we see he goes through this anguish and then this presentation of himself to the Lord and this realization that God is with him, he comes to this realization that the greatest gift he has is that God is with him through everything. And in verse 28, he ends up with sort of a reformulation of that beginning word of praise where he says, but for me it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge to tell of all your works. What's happened over the course of the psalm is the psalmist has moved from praise to questioning to anguish to prayer to thanksgiving. What I love about verse 28, it's almost like a reformulation of verse 1, but it's a reformulation in a very personal way. It's not just that God is with the upright, but it is that God is with me, that God is with us, that he walks with us, even when we experience how unfair the world can be. Once we realize this, that God is with us, we have a second question, which is, what will we do about it? In Romans, the Apostle Paul has written 11 chapters talking about what he believes about God to introduce himself to the Romans, to justify his ministry and his faith, and to give sort of a systematic understanding. But beginning in verse 12, he starts to talk about how we are to live once we know who God is. Once we know that God walks with us, what are we to do when we confront the injustice and the unfairness of the world? Listen to what Paul writes in verses 14 through 21 in Romans chapter 12. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head. Do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. When we see that life is unfair, when we experience in our own lives the inequity and the injustice of life, when we see it in the world and it makes us boil up with rage, when we're frustrated and angry, what are we to do? Well, the psalmist tells us that all of us experience that, and it's okay to express that anger and that frustration and to express it to the Lord, but ultimately to bring it to him so that he can transform our frustration into praise and our anger into confidence of his presence with us. And in Romans, the Apostle Paul tells us that when we see the injustice of the world, what we are to do is we are to live as the disciples of Christ. We are to live as people who are not overcome with evil, but people who overcome evil with good. That we are to love our neighbors. That we are to walk with those who experience injustice and unfairness. That we are to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. God never promised us that life would be fair. What he does promise is that he will be with us wherever we go. And that if we call on his name, he will show up to us and he will walk with us with our right hand in his, knowing the strength of his presence. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you that you do indeed walk with us. And your love for us is so great. Lord, we pray that we would not be overwhelmed by the injustice and the unfairness of this life and this world, but we would instead be inspired to turn to you and to trust in you, knowing that our lives and our world are in your hands, and that you are just and good, and Lord, that you are fair. Fair not in that you give us what we deserve, but fair in that you pour out your grace upon us so that we might be whole. Lord, we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing, it's okay. The last thing I need to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Won't you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Please join with me in prayer. Ever-loving God, we come before you knowing you listen and care for us in our every need. You know the prayers of our heart even before one word is uttered. So we come to you seeking hope and peace and justice. Turn your ears to our cry. Lord, we pray for your church, the people whom you've called out of every nation and tongue. We pray that through the work of your Holy Spirit, whom you have given to us, your church would be united, one in spirit, one in truth, in fellowship and love. Lord, we especially pray for our brothers and sisters in worn-torn places in need of your healing and restoring touch. We pray for your persecuted church. We pray that you would give them courage and strength to boldly live out their faith so that your name would be made great. Lord, we also pray for Haiti and the people and communities we have partnered with in recent years as COVID-19 has begun to trickle in. We pray, O God, for a miraculous intervention as they have been devastated time and time again. Father, we pray for all of our mission partners, those who are local and those across the globe. We pray that you would work in and through them so that they may faithfully and powerfully proclaim the gospel so the lives might be changed by you. Lord God, we pray for our nation. We pray for wisdom, discernment, compassion, and humility for our leaders, especially as we continue to wrestle with the coronavirus pandemic. Give our leaders the wisdom they need to make difficult decisions in the days ahead. We lift up the many healthcare workers, nurses, aides, and other professionals who are on the front lines caring for those who are sick and hurting. May you strengthen and protect them and watch over their loved ones. Lord, we also pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. We lift up the families of Ina Morgan, Walt King, and Donna King. We also pray for Susan Birkelbach, whose mother is recovering from a heart attack. We pray, O God, that you would surround them with your comforting presence. We pray for healing for Lauren Keatley as she's recovering from shoulder dislocation. We pray for strength and endurance. We lift up many who are struggling and searching for peace and comfort, for families who are facing stress due to having to care for their family while working. We pray for those who are undergoing financial strain because of job reduction or loss. We lift up our students, especially our seniors, as they've had an abrupt end to their year and look towards the next chapter of their journey. Lord, we pray that you would guide them. Lord, in the midst of our lives that seem like there's a storm raging and chaos surrounds us, we pray that you would be the center of our calm and the source of our peace. Grant us the peace that is beyond our understanding and guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, who taught all of his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. All God's children said, amen.
God never promised us that life would be fair. What he promises in his word is even better than that, that he will be with us no matter what happens. So as you go out this week, go knowing that you do not go alone, but you go with the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, which are with you now and forever. Amen.